In this video, I'll be fitting a PiTube coprocessor to my BBC master. The tube is a peripheral interface designed by Acorn to communicate with second processors. I'll be fitting this to the internal tube interface, the two sockets highlighted here. The assembly is comprised of a Raspberry Pi Zero and an interface board to convert the 5V signals from the tube interface to the 3.3V required for the Raspberry Pi. Details of this project can be found by searching for PiTubeDirect in Google. The site also includes firmware to be copied onto the Raspberry Pi SD card. Once installed, the PiTubeDirect software appears as a 6502 second processor connected to the BBC master. There are a couple of built-in benchmarking programs available to run, in order to quickly test whether the board is working to spec. The PiTubeDirect 6502 coprocessor is clocked at around 274 MHz. This is a lot faster than Acorn's official 6502 coprocessor board speed of 3 MHz. The processor is of course emulated on the Raspberry Pi. The built-in demos don't really give you a feel for how fast the computer runs with the PiTube coprocessor, so I decided to write a couple of more visual demos to compare the performance against the same machine with the PiTube interface disabled. The most obvious demo to write would be a basic program to render a Mandelbrot set fractal. Here we have that code running accelerated on the left. I'm running on a stock BBC master on the right. As you can see, there's really no competition. It's worth noting that the main bottleneck for the tube interface is input and output. For example, any code that accesses the disks frequently, or in this case, is writing to the screen, will be significantly slowed down by the 2 MHz 6502 main processor handling those requests. Code running on the coprocessor cannot access the screen or peripherals directly, so restricted to using the Acorn OS calls. Any well-behaved basic or assembly language code should run fine on the coprocessor. The tube chip in an original BBC coprocessor is a custom ULA. It provides 4 bidirectional queues, allowing the BBC micro and the coprocessor to reliably exchange messages with full flow control. In PiTubeDirect, the functionality of this chip is emulated in software on the Raspberry Pi, and the tube host interface on the BBC Micro is connected to the Raspberry Pi's GPIO headers via a pair of level shifter chips on the interface board. I posted some interim results on Twitter, and one of my followers, Gordon Henderson, suggested an interesting test to see exactly how PiTube compares to his Ruby 6502 running at 16 MHz. The test is an ASCII Mandelbrot set, so I typed in the listing and ran it. It took 2.8 seconds, compared to 48 on Gordon's kit. That's pretty fast. So let's see how well this runs on a standard BBC Micro then. Yeah, okay, that's not really the fastest, is it? I think we're going to have to forward wind this a little bit. So about 140 times slower. I had another BBC basic program I'd written that I wanted to try. This one's a rotating 3D cube demo written in BASIC. The code's unoptimised and it uses a fair amount of floating point trigonometry, so it's probably a fair test of how much the PiTube can accelerate maths calculations. In addition to the 274 MHz 6502 coprocessor, the PiTube can emulate a number of other coprocessors, including a 3 MHz 6502 for compatibility, a Z80, a 286, and a 1 GHz native ARM co-processor. To run non-6502 variants of BBC Basic, or other languages, you have to load the appropriate interpreter into RAM. Here I'm loading the ROM version of Z80 BBC Basic into Sideways RAM. Let's just check it's loaded okay. Ah, it's unplugged, so I need to insert it in now. The coprocessor is selected using an FX command. In this case, FX151 230 4. Hit Ctrl D and the new coprocessor boots up. Note that it's automatically selected the Z80 Basic language ROM. So let's see how well the emulated Z80 coprocessor, running at 112 MHz, runs the ASCII Mandelbrot set. You probably noticed that I loaded the same BASIC program as before. Thankfully, all variants of BBC BASIC can load the same programs. This is considerably slower than the 274 MHz 6502, but still faster than the stock Beeb. So that's rolled in at 22.5 seconds, not too shabby. The 1 GHz native ARM coprocessor is the most intriguing of the lot. This must run unemulated on the Raspberry Pi core. It's a little bit fiddly to set up. The BASIC's loaded into RAM rather than ROM. And there seem to be some issues with it sharing BASIC program space. I suspect this is because I'm using an older version. It's loaded at 1000, and then you need to go into the entry point, which is F12C. And don't worry too much about the file not found error. So I'm going to load up the Mandelbrot set program again. Again, we can use the same ASCII Mandelbrot set program as before with no issues. And that's considerably quicker at 1.3 seconds. Finally, Acorn released a tube version of Elite to run on the 6502 coprocessor. Let's see how fast that runs at 274 MHz. The spinning spaceships in the trap mode are slightly faster, but not significantly. This will probably be down to the bottleneck mentioned earlier. The coprocessor will be doing all the maths, but the 2 MHz BBC master will be responsible for rendering the scenes. There is one part of the trap mode that is much, much quicker. This is the Star Wars-esque text that is cut in between the spinning ship screens. I forgot to mention that the screen on the left is running on a 6502 tube running at 274 MHz, whilst the screen on the right is running on the tube interface running at 3 MHz. Also on a 6502. Notice how smooth the text is on the left hand side as it scrolls into the distance. The 3 MHz coprocessor on the right hasn't got to that bit yet. So we've cut now to the same text running on the 3 MHz 6502 coprocessor. Just watch how much it slows down now as more text comes onto the screen. Incidentally, if you ever try playing Elite at 274 MHz on a BBC master, it's practically unplayable. It's really quick, in fact it's too quick. That's partly because it's not frame locked at 50 or 60 Hz. It's worth a go though, just for the fun of it. Anyway, as ever, I hope you've enjoyed this video. Please subscribe to my channel and pop over to breakintoprogram.co.uk for more retro goodness.